love her in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? We kill the flame.
Friday the 13th, The Carnival, Chapter 9, Merry-Go-Round. It was a good thing Vince Fantana ordered his workers to put up carnival posters far and wide, because nobody from the town of Crystal Lake came to the carnival at night. Nobody. The few customers they got came from much farther away, like the Barfield family. The Barfields drove an hour from their vacation bungalow near Tanglewood, where they had come to hear the famous outdoor concerts of classical music. Instead, they went an hour out of their way because little Bobby wanted to ride what he called a merry-round. Mr. Barfield gritted his teeth. He had a few choice comments in mind for his wife the next time they were alone about the importance of disciplining their only child. But right now, he just wanted to find the damn carousel and be done with it. The Crystal Lake Carnival was a big fenced-in rectangle, about the size of a football field. Near the entrance stood a little white gazebo where customers could buy non-refundable ride tickets at 25 cents apiece. To be safe, Mr. Barfield bought $10 worth. The rides and booths were positioned in long rows, creating a maze of narrow, grassy lanes. Most of the lanes were dominated by game booths. The barkers yelled at the young couple from both sides. Step right up! Check it out! Win a prize for that cute little boy! Come on, mister! Don't be a tightwad! Mr. Barfield ignored all of their pleas, because the cute little boy had already made his intentions crystal clear. It was merry-go-round or bust. Who knew how Bobby had gotten the idea in his head? But once it was in there, there seemed to be no way to distract the three-year-old from his goal. But where was the carousel? The possibility that the carnival might not even have one filled Mr. Barfield with a deep dread.
Why don't we just ask someone where the merry-go-round is? Asked chunky Mrs. Barfield in a whiny voice.
We'll find it, Mr. Barfield promised grimly.
His wife glared at him.
Why are you so afraid of asking directions? Could you answer me that?
Mr. Barfield was carrying Bobby on his shoulders. Instead of answering, he tightened his grip on his son's pudgy thighs as they dangled around his head.
Merry-round, Mr. Barfield said.
Merry-round, he heard Bobby say above his head.
Even after all these hours of crying, there was still a catch in the toddler's throat, like he might start bawling again any second. And then, as they turned the corner, Mr. Barfield finally heard it. Mixed in with the organ grinder music of the fair was a sweet, tinkly tune. His heart leaped at the sound. Sure enough, up ahead he saw the wooden horses, riding in a slow circle, gently bobbing up and down.
Merry-round! Cried Bobby.
He was clapping his hands and digging his toddler-sized Reeboks into his daddy's throat.
Oh, thank God! Exclaimed Mrs. Barfield.
See, I told you I'd find one, Mr. Barfield said.
He permitted himself one huge I told you so grin. Then he lowered his son to the ground. Bobby ran forward so fast that Mrs. Barfield had to chase after him. While Mr. Barfield gave the carny operator his ride tickets, Mrs. Barfield positioned the boy on the wooden saddle of a large white stallion. The horse's wooden body was slightly reared. Its mouth was gaping open, as if chomping at the bit.
James, come on, Mrs. Barfield yelled at her husband.
I'll stay out here, he said, and take some shots.
The carny stepped into the control booth and started the ride. Slowly, the horses began to move faster. Mrs. Barfield and her son were the only ones on the ride. The heavy-set blonde woman was standing behind her heavy-set young son, making sure that Bobby kept his little hands on the wooden handles that jutted out of the horse's head like Frankenstein bolts. Bobby looked so serious, thought Mr. Barfield.
Smile!
He yelled from behind his camera. Mrs. Barfield smiled and waved, but not Bobby. Mr. Barfield cussed. You would think that after driving them crazy for
4 hours, Bobby would at least have the decency to act happy. As he snapped the pictures, Mr. Barfield kept adjusting the focus. But every time he focused, the image blurred again. James! Mr. Barfield pulled his eye away from the camera. Right away, he saw why his wife had yelled. The merry-go-round was going too fast, rising and falling. The wooden horses plunged forward wildly, their wooden jaws gaping. His wife called again. She was holding on to Bobby with one hand now, holding the white horse with the other. Tell him! The ride whipped her around in a circle and out of view, scattering the rest of her message into the humid night air. James looked around wildly for the carny. He saw the tall, thin man emerging from the control booth, ever so nonchalant.
Hey!
Mr. Barfield yelled. The operator had already seen what was happening on the ride. He rushed back into the control booth, but the ride started going faster, not slower. Mr. Barfield could feel the wind from the whistling ride hitting his face. Mrs. Barfield was screaming now, her long blonde hair whipping behind her like a pennant. She was clinging to the horse and her son. Bobby was crying worse than he had cried all afternoon. Mr. Barfield dodged through the metal gates and rushed toward the ride, but the spinning disc was a blur of speed. There was no way he could climb on board. He turned, looking for help. Sure enough, a crowd was gathering, but everyone was just standing there gaping at the ride. The carny was in the booth, working frantically at the controls, and then it was as if a plug had been pulled. The ride began to slow down, gently coasting to a halt. Before the ride had stopped completely, Mr. Barfield jumped onto the spinning wooden platform. He fell, banging his head against the wooden rump of a black horse. He was back on his feet quickly, though, dodging around the horses. He hugged his wife, who was hugging Bobby. Mother and son were both crying, and so, to Mr. Barfield's surprise, was he. A moment later, the carny was at their side. He was scratching his big, bald head, his Adam's apple bobbing. "Don't know why that happened," he said nervously. Mr. Barfield didn't have time for the carny. Not yet. He was focused on Bobby. The boy was clutching one arm against his little chest. Both parents bent over him, gently trying to pull the arm free.
"Let me see, Bobby," Mr. Barfield coaxed. "Let Daddy see."
The boy appeared to be in shock. It didn't help that the crowd of gawkers had climbed onto the merry-go-round, and that the boy found himself in the center of a thick knot of people.
Mean horse bite, Bobby,
the boy said softly, keeping his eyes down. There was laughter from the crowd.
What's that? What did he say?
The remark was passed along as if in a rapid game of telephone. There was more laughter. Finally, Bobby stopped clutching his arm and let his parents see the wound. There was a cut, all right, a mean-looking gash.
"Uh-oh," the carny said. "Looks like he scraped himself on the horse's teeth."
Bobby stared up at the man. He shook his head firmly.
"Horsey bite me."
There was a commotion as someone pushed his way through the crowd. He was a short, balding man with tiny eyes and long, silvery hair that was swept straight back. He was dressed kind of like a cowboy. By this time, Mr. Barfield had calmed down enough to get angry. He was about to start shouting at the carny, but the arrival of the man with the little eyes distracted him.
"I'm Vince Fontana," said the man briskly, putting his hand on Mr. Barfield's shoulder. "I own this carnival. I want you folks to come with me, please."
And within 20 minutes, the three Barfields were on their way back to Tanglewood with a million apologies from Vince and a huge stuffed bunny rabbit for Bobby, compliments of the Fontana Traveling Funhouse and Carnival. As soon as they left, Vince hurried back to the carousel, where he chewed the head off the carny operator.
"You trying to ruin me?" Vince shouted. "Mr. Fontana, I swear it wasn't my fault. It just took off. I don't know how, but..."
"All right," Vince said, turning away in disgust.
"Get Deaver. Tell him to take a look at it right away."
"I've been calling him," the ride operator said. "He doesn't answer his walkie-talkie." Mr. Fontana kept walking away. The ride operator could see how furious the old man was by the set of his shoulders.
"Just get him," Fontana ordered, without turning back. "Now!"
Maxie had the air conditioning in her mom's BMW going full blast, but she was still sweating. She slapped the steering wheel as hard as she could. I should go back and apologize, right?
Definitely, KC agreed, nodding her head vehemently.
Yeah, I know I should. Right, Wendy?
Right.
It was almost 9. Maxie was driving about 20 miles an hour too fast down Birch Lane, a narrow country road. It wasn't so much that Maxie was in a hurry to get where they were going. It was that she needed to get away from where they had been. Why did everything always fall to pieces? First, this morning, Jeff McGuinn's grandmother had had a stroke. Maxie couldn't have cared less about the old crone, but it meant that Jeff's parents canceled their vacation plans and Jeff's party. So Maxie, KC, and Wendy trooped over to Maxie's house to borrow her mom's car and go to the movies. But Mom was drunk, as usual, and Dad wasn't home, as usual, and when Maxie made a nasty crack about his absence, she and her mom ended up having a huge raging fight, as usual. Maxie had said things that she knew she'd regret. In fact, she'd already regretted them, and when she drove off, her mom stood on the doorstep crying and saying, "Please be careful." Maxie couldn't get that image out of her mind. "It just pisses me off so much," she said. "The way that she just takes it from him, you know." "What's she supposed to do?" Wendy asked. She was in the back seat, but she was leaning forward and she was talking right in Maxie's ear. "Divorce him," Maxie said bluntly. She turned right so sharply that the wheel screeched. "She's supposed to divorce him." She was on a wider, faster road now. She stepped on the gas until she was once again exceeding the speed limit.
"Maxie," KC said, "that's your own father you're talking about."
"I know who I'm talking about, KC. Thank you very much. What'd you think, I was talking about your father?"
"Maybe she doesn't want to divorce him," Wendy said. "I mean, she does have some problems of her own, you know. And if you don't mind driving a little slower, Maxie, I'd like to live to be 18.
"The F word," Maxie said, followed by the Y word.
"If anyone translate that, I'm getting out of this car and walking home," KC threatened.
"She's such a coward," Maxie said through gritted teeth, ignoring KC entirely.
"She is such a coward. I mean, everyone knows what's going on. Everyone. So, what does she do? She gets plowed."
"She's an alcoholic," Wendy observed gleefully. "I mean, what do you expect her to do?"
"Yeah," Maxie said. "She's an alkie. And how did she get that way? She got that way because Dad is a total workaholic. He's never home, ever. How else is Mom supposed to spend her time?"
"Excuses, excuses," Wendy said happily. She always got happy when they talked about the troubles in Maxie's life.
"I mean," she said, "did you ever think that part of the reason your dad works so much is to keep away from your mom?"
Maxie didn't answer. The thing was, she was terrified that Wendy might be right. Truth or dare, she told herself. Did her mom share some of the blame for the mess at home? Rather than answer that question, Maxie gave herself a dare and took it.
"Maxie!"
Casey screamed as Maxie swerved into the left lane, right into an oncoming truck. Chapter 10, Fate. The truck's air horn blared. The huge silver front grille zoomed toward them like a monster's face. Maxie turned the wheel hard, making it back into her lane at the last possible second. KC was shaking. Wendy was screaming.
"Are you out of your mind?"
"Sorry," Maxie said casually. "Lost my concentration there for a second." She couldn't hold it in. She started laughing. She ended up having to apologize all the way to the movie theater and having to talk KC and Wendy out of going home about 3 times apiece. It was worth it. The close brush with death had knocked her fight with her mom right out of her mind, and by the time she pulled into the parking lot of the little strip of stores known as the Carrollton Mall, her friends were speaking to her again.
Carrollton Mall was the largest mall for miles. It was tiny. It was also jammed.
The movie's probably sold out, Maxie predicted gloomily. She parked the black BMW at an angle across the white lines, blocking another space. She suddenly felt very alone. She wasn't. The battered blue Ford Taurus, which had been tailing Maxie since she left her dorm, now nosed softly into the parking lot. Maxie slammed her door just for the hell of it.
Hey, don't lock it, she snapped at KC as she went about trying to lock all the doors.
I told you, dumbhead, I want it to get stolen.
KC threw up her hands. I can't do anything right.
Don't worry about her, Wendy said. She must be getting her period. You're getting your period, aren't you, Maxie?
A few yards up ahead, Maxie called without turning back.
Go ahead, just shout out my menstrual cycle all over the parking lot. Why don't you?
As they headed toward the theater, the blue Taurus parked quietly on the other side of the crowded lot. The driver sat watching the three girls as they approached the ticket window. He was shaking.
What in God's name am I doing? He asked himself. This is insane, following her around like this. I'm a grown man. But it was as if he had lost control of his own body. It was as if he were possessed. The man shouted at himself to stay in the car, to drive away. But instead, he turned off the ignition. Then he quietly opened the car door, just as Maxie walked up to the ticket booth. The woman in the booth was on the phone and didn't look up. Not even when Maxie tapped on the glass. Maxie could feel her fury rising. She tapped a second time. This time, the woman did look up, but she scowled angrily. She held up her forefinger and arced her eyebrows, obviously miming the message, "Wait."
"Look at her," Maxie growled. "Why doesn't she just do her job?"
"She's on the phone," Casey said, pleading Maxie.
Maxie glared at her. KC would wait on a line for hours rather than risk being rude to anyone. Finally, the ticket seller hung up the phone. She leaned forward to speak through the tiny microphone.
The 9 o'clock show is sold out. Sorry, ladies.
Maxie slapped the glass in frustration.
Do you mind? The woman behind the glass said, glaring. I'm a person, you know. I'm in here.
Sorry. Maxie turned to her friends. See what I mean? Nothing works out. Damn it. She took a hard kick at a brown Snapple bottle that was lying on the pavement. She missed, almost falling over. Wendy laughed.
The K-word, she said. Klutz!
Oh, very funny.
The S-word, KC agreed, smiling.
The S-word? Maxie asked.
Serves you right, Casey said, her smile broadening.
That doesn't even make sense, Maxie said. You don't know how to play. But Wendy was laughing harder now, and so was Casey. And abruptly, Maxie found herself joining in. In fact, she started laughing so hard she had to hold her stomach.
You guys, she said, when she had finally stopped giggling enough to speak.
She put a long arm around Casey's shoulders, then Wendy, pulling them close.
What would I do without you?
Kill yourself, probably, Wendy said.
Thanks, but she grinned. She was having a memory flash like deja vu all the way back to when she was 9, and Casey and Wendy were 8, and they were seeing their first movie on their own at Carrollton Mall. They had laughed a lot that time, too. Laughed so hard, and not about the movie, that they had been thrown out.
Hey, she said. You guys are great, you know that?
Maybe she was getting her period, thought Maxie, because her feelings were all over the place.
One second she was laughing hysterically, now she suddenly felt like crying again.
KC was beaming at her. You're the sweetest, she said.
KC was terrific at giving compliments, but they were often outrageous.
Maxie, sweet? That was a laugh, Maxie thought. She leaned back against the white brick wall of the movie theater. She rocked on her heels so that her back bumped up against the bricks again and again.
So what are we going to do tonight?
Hey, said Casey, we can go bowling.
I'm not going bowling, Wendy said. I just want that on the record right now. Last time, I thought I was going to die of shame.
Wendy, Casey started in. The owner was just mad because he said you were denting the lane when you kept dropping the Here's what we'll do, Maxie interrupted. We find someone to buy us some liquor or drugs, and then we get totally wasted out on the athletic field.
Maxie, Casey said, you better be joking.
Why? Why what? Asked a familiar voice. All three girls looked up.
Graham, Casey gushed. I mean, Mr. Newton.
No, you mean Graham. Graham is just fine. The teacher was standing in front of them, arms crossed. He was wearing a torn old t-shirt, khaki shorts, sandals. It was strange to see him out of his usual teaching clothes. But Maxie had to admit he looked more handsome than ever.
What are you doing here? Wendy asked.
Well, I was going to see a movie, but I see by that little notice in the box office window that I am a bit too late.
Join the club, Casey said in a sing-song voice, and laughed nervously.
Maxie hadn't gone by Graham's office that afternoon, as he had asked. Frankly, she wasn't interested, but she was still glad to see him. She loved distractions.
So, she said, how come you're all by yourself for the big 4th of July weekend?
Graham's eye twinkled.
Ah, well, he said, for us Englishmen, your country's Independence Day is really more of a day of mourning, you know. I like to be alone with my thoughts.
Everyone laughed, and Graham proudly grinned his toothy grin. He started with KC, but he ended up smiling at Maxie, and he kept his gaze there.
This is quite a coincidence, eh? He asked.
No one answered him. There was an awkward pause. Maxie was about to say something, but she stared at KC, willing her to talk instead. They'd had plenty of fights throughout the years where KC accused Maxie of stealing her guys. The fact was, KC always panicked around men and got deathly silent. What was Maxie supposed to do? Stay silent along with her? This time, they were literally saved by the bell. It sounded like organ grinder music, a mindless, happy tune that was playing slightly off-key and kept repeating itself over and over.
Look, Maxie said.
Everyone looked. A large white truck was pulling into the parking lot. Painted across one whole side of the truck was a colorful ad for the carnival in Crystal Lake. The driver of the truck was a clown. There was a second clown on the passenger side, waving slowly and broadly. Despite their huge, brightly painted smiles, both clowns looked quite grim. The truck made a slow circle through the lot.
Hey, everybody, one of the clowns yelled as they went by. Why don't you come to the carnival?
Maybe we will, Maxie called back.
You better, the clown said. He pointed his finger like a gun and fired an imaginary bullet.
Bang, he said.
Maxie laughed.
Don't even think about it, Wendy said as the truck drove away.
I don't think we have any other choice, Maxie said. It's beginning to look like fate.
We have a choice, Wendy said. Believe me.
What's all this? Graham asked.
Wendy's afraid of the carnival because Crystal Lake is supposed to be haunted, Maxie explained, enjoying the embarrassed look on Wendy's round face.
Wendy shoved her.
Shut up, that's not true.
To their teacher, she added, that's a total lie. Afraid of a carnival, that's so ridiculous, Maxie.
Maxie just laughed, nothing like teasing a friend to pass the time.
I'll get you, Wendy warned under her breath, but Maxie only laughed harder.
Graham was laughing too.
A haunted carnival, but that only adds to the fun now, doesn't it?
That's what I think, Maxie agreed.
She smiled at him, her best sexy smile. Over the last couple of years, she'd found that it only took a few of those smiles to get any guy to ask her out. They were like magic bullets.
Want to join us? She asked.
Ah, I would love to. It's just...
Blushing, he glanced quickly at Casey and Wendy. He couldn't seem to come up with an excuse.
It's just what? Maxie asked, giving him a sly look.
Graham wiped the sweat from his forehead.
God, this heat. It makes me feel brain dead, you know?
Anyway, I'm sure they're all so very exciting.
He held up one hand in a sort of salute. Anyway, I'll take a rain check. Good weekends, all. Cheerio. The three girls gave him a chorus of farewells as he turned and headed off into the parking lot. Maxie watched him go. Was she right about him or what? If he was interested in her, why didn't he agree to come along? There was no way to know. She watched him get into his car. She was feeling mad again. Come on, she told her friends. Let's get out of here. Where are we going? Wendy asked warily. Maxie grinned and slapped her loudly on the back. The C-word.
The carnival?
Guessed Casey, clapping her hands. The carnival, Maxie said. Chapter 11. A Free Ride. The Fantana Carnival was bright, loud, and flashy, but less than 100 yards from the fairgrounds loomed the dark woods of Crystal Lake. Here, the noise from the fair was muted and distant. Here, nature still ruled. For a moment, the forest was deathly silent. Then suddenly, the quiet was shattered. An owl screeched as it caught its prey, a tiny rodent with its razor-sharp talons.
What in God's name was that? Asked a low voice.
That was an owl, stupid. Geez, haven't you ever hiked around the woods before?
Are you crazy? I told you, I'm from New Rochelle. We don't hike, we ride in carpools.
Just come on. Crunching over leaves, the two boys emerged into a patch of moonlight. One of the boys was a stocky 15-year-old with a round, immediately likable face. His name was sewn into every piece of his expensive clothes, from his shirt to his socks. Bernard LeBlat.
How much further? He whined.
Just listen, stupid, the other boy said. He put his hand on Bernard's shoulder.
Can't you hear it?
Bernard listened to the sounds of the woods, the crickets and the frogs, and also he could hear the carnival in the distance.
What if we get lost? Then what?
Nick Harris laughed.
You're pathetic. You know that? How could we get lost?
Nick was right. It was almost impossible to get lost. For one thing, there were those huge revolving spotlights way up in the sky guiding their way. Also, they could occasionally see the top of the Ferris wheel spinning through the breaks in the trees. And as they trekked through the thick triangle of brush, the fair's organ grinder music chimed louder and louder, drawing them forward like a magical lure. They were almost there.
Okay, what if there's a fence? Bernard asked.
There won't be a fence. You think they're worried about a lot of kids sneaking through these woods?
No, nobody but us would be that stupid.
There won't be a fence.
But what if there is?
Then we'll climb over it, duh. Bernard cursed and hissed.
Wait a second, would ya?
Nick stopped and waited, hands on hips, frowning with impatience. He watched as his stocky friend tried to remove the prickers from a vine that had stuck itself into his bare, flabby thigh. Head bent low, Bernard frowned with concentration as he performed his minor surgery. He cursed again.
I told you to wear long pants, the other boy reminded him.
Though he had already turned 16, Nick was shorter and skinnier than his friend. Unlike Bernard's brand name outfit, Nick's clothes had a ratty second-hand look. They didn't have his name sewn into them either. But at least his worn-out old jeans protected him from the vicious, thorny vines that flourished in the woods of Crystal Lake.
How did I lose my flashlight? Bernard moaned.
Rich kids are dumb. You know what?
What would you do with a big old flashlight once we're inside the carnival?
What are we going to do inside the carnival without any money?
Bernard and Nick were both from Camp Topeka in Cranville, about 30 miles away.
That afternoon, one of Bernard's bunkmates had stolen his wallet. The camp director, Mr. Standiford, had personally vowed to catch the culprit. But in the meantime, Bernard was broke, just as broke as his skinny friend Nick, who was attending camp on a scholarship. Nick was shaking his head in annoyance.
I explained all this stuff to you 100 times.
Make it 101.
Once we're inside the carnival, they'll figure we paid admission. Then you just say you spent all your ride tickets and, you know, they'll feel sorry for you. You'll see. We'll get on plenty of rides. You look younger. You look like you're like 12.
I've done this kind of thing all my life.
And we'll have Lots of fun, right?
Right.
Because I'm beginning to think this was a real dumb idea. Bernard had stopped to rest again, leaning up against the wide trunk of a big oak tree. With an annoyed sigh, Nick leaned back against the tree next to his friend, which meant that both boys were staring back the way they had come.
Dumb, 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 Bernard said with a sigh.
He counted off his complaints on his pudgy fingers.
First, we could get kicked out of camp if they do a bunk check and find out that it's our pillows that are stuffed into our sleeping bags instead of us. Second, we could have gotten killed hitchhiking over here. That guy,
he was just a little drunk, Nick said, waving the complaint away.
And third,
Bernard didn't finish his third complaint. Instead, he stared bug-eyed at his friend in the darkness.
What's third?
Nick asked, but he had caught the other boy's fear. He lowered his voice to a whisper.
Sorry, Bernard said at last. I thought I heard something. Third is what those counselors said at the campfire last night about Crystal Lake. All that stuff about that guy Jason?
Nick's jaw dropped.
You believe that crap?
Bernard shrugged his round shoulders defensively.
No, of course not, he said. But you know...
The truth was, Bernard thought the counselors had been very convincing. They said that Camp Topeka was the only camp within 100 miles of Crystal Lake, because people were so scared of all the horrors that had happened here. And this carnival music was not making him feel any more at ease.
Dumbhead, Nick said. Counselors love to scare you.
Bernard shrugged again. How did he get himself into these things? He knew how. Nick was pretty much the only kid at Camp Topeka who was nice to him. He didn't want to risk losing Nick's friendship by refusing to come along. The pine trees swayed and rustled as if in a breeze, but Bernard didn't feel any cold drafts. All he felt was the humid air pressing down on him like a hand.
You know what I am looking forward to? He said, talking a little bit louder. I can't wait to tell the guys what we did tonight, and... He gulped. I think I heard footsteps.
His eyes were locked on Nick's. His voice was barely audible. Nick peered into the pitch-black woods. He didn't see anything.
You're such a wuss, man, he said, but he was whispering too.
Listen,
Bernard insisted. And this time Nick had to admit he did hear footsteps. They seemed to be coming right this way. Then he heard something else. A faint hissing sound, like someone letting the air out of a tire. Bernard grabbed Nick's arm, gripping it hard.
Let's run!
Wait,
Nick insisted, because he still couldn't see anything coming through the woods. Bernard grabbed him with both hands, shaking him.
Nick!
But still, Nick did not move. And then Bernard grabbed him again. Only this was Bernard's third hand. Nick looked up. A tall man in a white mask was staring down at him, eyes leering through the mask's dark holes. The man had come up behind them, from the other side of the tree. He had grabbed the skinny boy by the neck of his ratty white t-shirt. Now he pulled Nick several inches off of the ground, scraping him upward along the tree's rough bark. It all happened in an instant. For 1 second, Nick saw the snake tattoo slithering on the man's hairy forearm. For 1 second, he had a spasm of guilt. It was about Bernard's wallet, which was resting comfortably in his back pocket. Then the man in the mask raised his other hand. This hand was holding a blowtorch. Nick tried to scream, but as he opened his mouth, the searing flame went past his lips, burning, burning, burning its way through the back of his throat. Bernard took a step back, hands hanging limply at his sides. His mouth hung open. He felt as if everything inside of him, flesh, bones, organs, feelings, had instantly drained out onto the leafy ground beneath his feet. He felt as if he had become utterly weightless, as light as a feather, and feathers couldn't move. They could not run. So he just watched stupidly while the large man with the tattoos worked away on his friend, the blowtorch hissing. The skinny boy's flesh was crackling and burning. Then the man let go. Nick crumpled, falling straight down with a thud as if he had dropped out of the tree above. The man in the mask turned and looked at Bernard. Suddenly, with a jolt, the stocky boy's limbs came back to life and he ran. The man was right behind him, loping easily through the darkness, dodging around trees, walking so fast, but not running, and still keeping pace. Bernard was too scared to scream. Though he had just started to run, he was totally out of breath. Fear had knocked the wind right out of him. Bernard's left arm smacked into a tree trunk that felt hard as a rock. He was sure his arm was broken, but he didn't have time to worry about it, because just then the crazy maniac's big hand clapped down on his back. The man had him by the scruff of his checkered shirt. There was a ripping sound as the man tore off the part of the shirt they always called the fairy loop at school. Bernard hated the way his classmates always ripped that loop. This time, though, he was immensely glad because it meant he was free. He raced forward so fast he almost fell, and then the man grabbed him a second time. The hand caught his shoulder this time, but Bernard managed to shake himself loose. He kept running. Now he felt the man's fingertips touching his neck. But before the large, strong hand could close around his throat, the boy dodged to the left and saw it. The carnival! He had come out of the woods, and it was as if the fairground's bright lights were physically smacking him in the face. The sight was so shocking and sudden. But between Bernard and the safety of the carnival, there was, despite all of his friend's promises, a fence. The fence was high with barbed wire on top. Bernard ran toward it. The man was right behind him. Bernard could hear the hiss of the torch, feel its heat on his back. He could also feel the man's footsteps thundering behind his, could feel him looming over him, reaching down for him. Bernard reached out with his good hand, the one that didn't feel useless and broken, and gripped the metal fence with all his might, hoping to scramble up and over as fast as lightning. He probably never would have made it anyway. Climbing fences had never been one of Bernard's talents. But the instant his stubby hand touched the fence, he heard something else sizzling. He felt a pain so great it boomed in his ears like gunfire. His hair stood on end. Then there was smoke, curling up from his hand, but he couldn't move it. He was paralyzed. His whole body started shaking violently. First his hand and then his entire body began to blister and pucker. A gigantic microwave couldn't have done the job any quicker. In less than a minute, Bernard LeBlanc was done to a crisp. Chapter 12. The Monster. Maxie was peeling out of the Carrollton Mall parking lot, laying down some rubber when...
Maxie, wait!
KC grabbed Maxie's arm. Maxie hit the brakes.
Isn't that Graham?
Sure enough, there he was, sitting behind the wheel of his Ford Taurus. He was frowning, and Maxie heard the familiar whine and groan of a car motor that wouldn't start.
He's flooding it, Maxie said matter-of-factly.
She felt strangely pleased. It served him right for trying to take off like that and ditch them. She turned right and circled back around the parking lot until she came up alongside Graham's car. She honked. Graham looked up. Surprised, he smiled weakly.
Wait here, guys, Maxie said. She left the motor running.
She was aware of Graham's eyes on her as she strolled over to his car. She was used to men watching her, and though Graham didn't really do anything for her, she enjoyed the attention. She leaned in the window.
We've got to stop meeting like this.
Maxie, Graham hesitated.
What?
But the look in the man's eyes, the tone of his voice, expressed his thoughts as clearly as if he had said them.
So, Maxie thought, she'd been right about him all along.
It just won't start, he said sheepishly.
Well, she drawled the words lazily.
Looks like you have to come with us after all, now doesn't it?
Greg Dillon stared up, up, up at the monster. The roller coaster hulked against the dark sky like some gigantic dinosaur skeleton. Greg didn't consider himself a particularly brave guy, but as scary as the ride looked, he couldn't muster any fear. Glumly, he counted out his ride tickets, handed them to the carny, stood at the gate for a moment, and started forward. The man held out a greasy hand. "It's 8 ride tickets." "What? Oh, sorry." Greg tore off 2 more tickets. Everyone at this fair was so nasty, he thought. There weren't exactly a whole lot of customers, so you'd think they'd be nicer to the ones they had. He wound his way through the twisty path of metal railings. The path had been set up to hold a long line, but for this next ride, Greg was going to be the monster's only victim. In a way, it should have been a dream come true, the fair being so deserted. For one thing, it meant Greg didn't have to wait for any of the rides. But instead, the empty fairgrounds made the whole carnival feel pointless. Why should he bother to go on these rides when there weren't a lot of other kids around, laughing and screaming their heads off? Well, it wasn't just that there weren't a lot of kids and other teens around, he thought bitterly. It's that one particular kid wasn't around. Maxie. The same carny who had taken Greg's tickets now hopped over the metal barricades and locked Greg into the first car, angrily snapping the safety bar in place. "Is this really the world's largest roller coaster?" Greg asked. "I mean, it doesn't look all that big." "What do you care?" the man demanded. He had rotten teeth and his breath smelled fishy. "Don't worry, kid. It'll take you around so fast you'll wish you were on the kiddie carousel. Keep your hands on the bar at all times or you're gonna die. You got it?" The carny gave him a happy grin, as if the thought of Greg dying cheered him greatly. Then he hurried off to the control booth to start the ride. The carny didn't check the safety bars on the other cars. Why should he? Those cars were all empty. At least that's what he thought. But in the rearmost car, a man had crouched down out of sight. Back in the control booth, the carny threw the lever that started the ride. During operation, he was supposed to keep his eyes on the ride at all times. To hell with that. He pulled a whiskey bottle from his back pocket, took a long slug, then bent his head over the day's sports pages. With a jolt, the long line of cars started their slow ascent up the coaster's first big hill. The chains of cars was like a caterpillar inching up a branch. Greg started singing, Maxie, softly to himself. He could picture her beautiful face so clearly, and once again the words that had become his mantra of the evening ran through his head. If only she were here. If Maxie were here, everything would be exciting. Just walking around the carnival with her would be 10 times more thrilling than riding this coaster. Of course, if Greg really wanted excitement, all he had to do was look behind him. The man in the back car was sitting up now. He had a mask on his face and an axe in his hand. Click, clack, click, clack. The cars kept clicking against the track as they rose endlessly upward. It sounded as if someone were winding up the tension on the ride, click after clack. Greg looked down. He really was pretty high up, a lot higher than it had seemed from the ground. Maybe it was the world's largest traveling coaster after all, he thought idly. He watched as the car rose up out of the brightly lit fairgrounds, and he saw the dark woods spread out below him. The green tops of the trees looked like a soft carpet, waiting to catch him if he fell. In the back car, Mitch was cursing. All those empty cars, only one lousy kid for him to butcher. Where was the fun in that? He swung one long, limber leg over the back seat of the next car, just as the monster's long line of cars began its first screaming descent. Greg screamed just for the hell of it, trying to get into the spirit of the ride. Ignoring the carny's instructions, he raised his hands off the safety bar. It didn't help. He still felt totally safe. He still knew that this was just a ride. Meanwhile, 7 cars back, Mitch almost did some screaming himself. He had come damn close to being thrown off the coaster, and he had dropped the axe. But luckily, the large metal weapon had landed in the wet, dank bottom of the car he was trying to climb into. Unluckily, one of Mitch's long legs was still sticking out the side of the car. and it was thwacking against the side of the metal track as they hurled downward. Sparks flew. It felt like his leg was getting electrocuted. Cursing wildly, Mitch finally managed to pull his leg inside. He righted himself. His body felt like it was burning. His snake tattoos hissed angrily. He grinned through the pain. That was quite a stunt. He congratulated himself. Only 6 more cars to go. But the monster was going faster now. So fast that Greg put his hands back on the safety bar. Where was Maxie right this second, he wondered. It wasn't a good question for him to ask. He knew the answer. She was out partying, probably dancing up close with some studly hunk, or worse, off in a dark corner making out. The idea twisted in his gut like a knife. Well, what did he expect? She had told Greg to forget about her. She couldn't have been much clearer than that. But the thing was, he didn't know if he could ever forget her. Not even for a single. The cars lurched through a hairpin turn, and for the first time, Greg found himself screaming for real. Wow, they were really cooking. 5 cars back, Mitch turned his masked head, trying to get a look down at the control booth. What was that idiot up to, running them around the track this fast? How was he going to kill that kid at this speed? But instead of slowing down, the cars went even faster, and Greg was screaming his heart out now, because it was hard for him to believe this ride was still under control. The cars kept hurtling, dipping, diving, twisting. It was as if the car was trying with all its might to throw Greg to his death. Then he remembered the words of the man Carney at the gate. Don't worry, kid. I'll take you around so fast you'll wish you were on the kiddie carousel. So that was it. The bastard was trying to scare him. Greg made a silent vow. As soon as he got back on the ground, if he ever did get back on the ground, he would head straight home. Enough was enough. The thought offered only slight comforts. The cars were traveling so fast now that Greg's freckled face was shaking violently up and down as if his flesh were about to come off. He gripped the iron safety bar with all of his might, his knuckles turning bright white. He was screaming, screaming so loudly he couldn't hear Mitch screaming just 3 cars behind him. Mitch started climbing into the second car, just as the cars flew into the coaster's first loop-the-loop. Greg felt sure he was going to drop right out of the coaster. As the car spun upside down, pins, coins, and other loose stuff from his pockets went flying out. His screams were mixed with gurgles. He was throwing up. And still the cars kept going faster. Greg started praying, praying for the ride to end soon, praying that he would survive this nightmare. He shut his eyes just as Mitch reached the car behind his. Grinning broadly behind his mask, the mechanic slowly stood. The wind cut into his chest like a blade. It whistled blindingly through the eye holes in his mask. Struggling desperately to keep his balance, he raised the axe over Greg's head. I'm a dead man, thought Greg miserably. You're a dead man, thought Mitch happily. Then he swung his axe down with all of his might, aiming right at Greg's skull. Okay, this has been chapters 9, 10, 11, and 12 of Friday the 13th, The Carnival. And this is the first time in a while I've actually got to end the upload on a cliffhanger. So, yeah, we're definitely leaving tonight's upload with one of the main and most likable characters' life hanging, literally hanging in the balance. Well, I think it's literally hanging. Were they still upside down or have they already come back around the loop? Anyways, that axe is coming down for his head. And I actually like this guy. And I think Maxie doesn't deserve him. You know, I'm like really getting into this young adult teen novel here. Maxie does not deserve Greg. She don't. He's too good of a guy for her. Anyways, guys, we had our first kill tonight by Jason. Well, the body that Jason is possessing and manipulating into doing this. So, I want to know what you guys think of tonight's upload, what you thought of the character development, what you think of the creepy teacher, what you think of Mitch's possession by Jason, the snake tattoos still being alive, the blowtorch death, and, of course, Greg's life hanging in the balance. Are you mad at me for stopping there? Should I have gone on one more chapter? Let me know in the comments section, and I'll be back very soon with more of Friday the 13th, The Carnival. Till then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80 slasher librarian saying thanks for listening, and don't visit this carnival because...
it's got a death curse!
I didn't know I had permission to murder into me. You want it darker. We kill the flame.
Ouch, 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 ouch. Stop it! Come on, stop it. Bad mask, bad mask. Hey! This is William Patterson, known to Friday the 13th fans as Eric Morse, and you are listening to 80s Slasher Librarians narration of my book, Friday the 13th, Carnival.